come, Lord, just thanking you for this privilege to stand one more time in this sacred spot and share in your holy word. Thank you, Father, that the worship has gone forth through music. Now, Lord, let us turn our attention to your word. Let us hear with understanding. May our lives, Lord, be changed and drawn closer to you. And of course, we always pray, Lord, if anyone here who's not here, we pray, Lord, that today they will come and accept your free gift of salvation. When all is said and done, may you have gotten the glory. We ask now in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Certainly to the preachers and deacons and all of you who gathered here on this day. Thank you, choir, for ministering to us so very, very well.
Amen.
That's the sermon in itself.
Amen.
So I want to invite you today to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 45 through 47. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 45 through 47. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. 45 through 47, and there we find these words recorded. And he opened their understanding, that they might comprehend the scriptures. And then he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. The topic is in the program, Staying on Assignment. Staying on Assignment. Last Sunday, Christians all over the world celebrated the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We celebrated the resurrection because his resurrection validates our faith. We celebrated his resurrection because it reassures us that our sins are forgiven. We celebrated his resurrection because it also assures us of our own resurrection.
Yes.
And because we have a living Savior, we can celebrate because we have every reason to be filled with joy and hope as we continue our journey from earth to glory. But now that Resurrection Sunday has passed, what do we do? Do we settle back into a business as usual mindset? Does the bright glow we displayed on Resurrection Sunday turn to a dimly lit light until Christmas or another Resurrection Sunday? Do we display a vibrant faith day in and day out, or do we live as folk who are just barely getting by? Do we, as followers of Jesus Christ, realize that we are on assignment, and that assignment will not be completed until the Lord returns or he takes us home through death? As students of Scripture, and I pray that you are, I pray that you're reading your Bibles, I pray that you're not waiting just for Sunday morning to open it up, but I pray that throughout the week, you are reading and studying the Scriptures. As students of Scripture, we are to know that we individually and collectively have been given an assignment by the Lord. An assignment that has grave implications as it relates to one's eternal destiny.
All right.
This is no game. But we have serious work to do. In Luke's gospel, Jesus reminds the disciples, prior to going back to heaven, that it was necessary for him to suffer and rise from the dead. Now, let us not forget that the Lord came to die for our sins. Yes, he healed a lot of folk and he fed a lot of folk, but he came to die for our sins. He came to shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. And his resurrection proves his power over sin, death, and Satan. And after his resurrection, and before going back to heaven, Jesus gave an assignment. And Matthew's gospel is known as the Great Commission. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. In the book of Acts, chapter numbers 8, it's simply known as being a witness, beginning at home and then spreading abroad. Luke specifically states that repentance and remission of sins is to be preached in his name, beginning at Jerusalem. The Greek word for preach simply means proclaiming. Proclaiming. And we know that preachers are called by God to do that specific thing. But I also believe that preaching takes place through ministry and the life that we live. So in a sense, all of us have been called to minister. We may not have been specifically called to preach, but all of us have been called to proclaim his goodness. All of us have been called to ministry and to live godly lives, which serves as a witness to the Lord's keeping and saving power. So you got a call on your life. Whether you realize it or not. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 talks about the priesthood of all believers. He says, But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praise of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous. Therefore, we as individuals and as a church, we have been given an assignment. Yes. And we are to be witnesses for the risen Savior. Yes. Now, this assignment is not masked in secrecy. It is quite clear. It is crystal clear. We are to inform people of the need for repentance and forgiveness. We are to remind people of the need for repentance and forgiveness. The Preachers Outline Study Bible defines repentance in this way. Repentance is to change, to turn, to change one's mind, to turn one's life. It is a turning away from sin and turning toward God. The change is turning away from lying, from stealing, from cheating, from immorality, cursing, drunkenness, and the other so-called glaring sins of the flesh. But the change is also turning away from the silent sins of the spirit, such as self-centeredness, selfishness, envy, bitterness, pride, covetousness, anger, evil thoughts, hopelessness, laziness, lust. Repentance is needed because humans have a sin nature inherited from Adam in the Garden of Eden. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And Jesus says, unless you repent, you will perish. So our lives, those who profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, our lives are the witnesses of people who have repented, changed from how we used to live. Lifestyle saying about you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses Matthew 11, it says this: "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God." But verse 11 is key. "And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord and by the Spirit of our God." In other words, we ought to be able to say, "I used to." I used to do this, and I used to do that. But since I met Jesus, change has come into my life. The Bible is clear. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. You don't stay the same once you come to Jesus. If you're still the same after having come to him, then something's wrong somewhere, and it's certainly not with him. Romans 6:4 says that we should walk in the newness of life. Ephesians 4:24 says, "Put on the new man, created according to God, in true righteousness and holiness." And then in Galatians 2:20, Paul says, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." What's the life saying about this? And how are we carrying out our assignment? Because all of us have an assignment to do. The assignment only has to do with getting people to understand the need for repentance, but to tell them how their sins can be covered. And as much as you love tithing, you can't tithe your way into heaven. As much as you love singing, you can't sing your way into heaven. As much as we love doing ministry, you cannot work your way into heaven. In the Old Testament, the Bible talks of animals being sacrificed so their blood would cover the sins of the people. But the New Testament shares the good news of Jesus Christ in that he died once and for all for the sins of many. And I'm so glad that we're no longer under the Old Testament system, but the New Testament, he shed blood for the forgiveness of my sins.
Such a
ushers tell me that when they're trying to do their duty, some folk come in at the door and are so nasty towards them. The ushers just trying to let folk in at the right moment in worship, but folk want to push through them, walk on back then. You got choir members singing the Lord's song and got such a frown on their face. Cripples come out the pulpit and live a life of sin outside the pulpit. Folks sitting in the pews who won't speak to the folk on the other side.
And be with